Good evening, I'm Scott Schaefer, sitting in tonight for Belva Davis. Welcome to This Week in Northern California. Joining me on our news panel are Dan Brecke, editor for KQED News, Josh Richmond, legal and political affairs reporter for the Oakland Tribune, and Carla Marinucci, political reporter for the San Francisco Chronicle. Carla, quite a kerfuffle in Wisconsin, sure. Ohio, Indiana. Boil it down for us. What's happening? What are the unions upset about? And what does it mean for us here in California?
Well, you know, it's been called a pension tsunami that's on its way to California. This story in Wisconsin really sort of broke open the whole issue this week. A lot of people wondering, could California face the same kind of protest and the same kind of action? I mean, the fact is, this is all about money, power, and politics. These unions, particularly public employees unions, are the heart of the Democratic Party. They provide money, they provide manpower, and in a state like Wisconsin, we saw a Republican governor just challenge them openly, try to end collective bargaining. A lot of California protesters are headed toward Wisconsin as we speak, with the concern about could this catch on here in California.
And how the concerns, I mean, in Wisconsin, you've got the whole issue of collective bargaining and the governor wanting to take that away. You've also got these other legitimate concerns about, can this be sustained?
That's right. I mean, look, here in California, the legislative analyst has said that, you know, right now, $136 billion is the unfunded liability in California. In the next 10 years, as much as $500 billion. This is a concern. Governor Jerry Brown has said it's a concern as he's trying to wrestle with the state budget, as we know, has $26 billion in red ink. Right now, the Republicans up there in Sacramento are sort of holding back on any kind of support for his budget plans, saying we want first some kind of pension reform in addition to regulatory reform and other things. But this is going to be sort of at the heart of the battle up there in Sacramento. It has to be addressed. Everybody says that, but California is not Wisconsin. That said, we've got a Democratic-controlled legislature and a governor who has been very, very friendly to organized
and we've had
labor.
A new wrinkle put into it this week by our nonpartisan Little Hoover Commission. What
that's
they
right, and that threw another a wrench into the whole thing. You're absolutely right, Josh. I mean, Little Hoover Commission, a nonpartisan watchdog group, talked about or suggested freezing pensions and lowering benefits for current employees. That created a firestorm up there in Sacramento.
But we should say it's nonpartisan, but the members of this current commission have been appointed by Governor Schwarzenegger.
That's right. But I mean, some of the reforms they've suggested, Republicans seized on those and said, see, you know, we need to get this under control right now. I mean, and Governor Brown has talked about some reforms, like a 401k kind of proposal. He had a pension reform plan when he ran for governor, but the fact is, he hasn't come out with any specifics, and the Republicans want it as part of the solution on his budget proposal.
Do the issues, though, of the pension problems, which everybody is talking about, here in San Francisco, we have Jeff Adachi, who's going to make run on this. are the pension problems really tracking so perfectly with collective bargaining? There was a bill introduced in the legislature today which would attack it.
That's right. I mean, it follows Wisconsin's lead. A Republican legislator has put it up there in Sacramento. Several Republican legislators have followed and said they are standing with Wisconsin on this, trying to get some kind of reform, trying to push the envelope here on the issue of collective bargaining. I mean, this was an issue back in the governor's race when Meg Whitman tried to suggest Jerry Brown in the pockets of the public employees unions was responsible for collective bargaining here in California. The fact is that Ronald Reagan was the first
in
1968 to establish collective bargaining for municipal and county employees. And from there, it expanded. Brown did expand it, no question about it. But this is a line in the sand for public employees unions.
But is Jerry Brown saying we can balance the budget, or I have a plan to balance the budget that doesn't include any of these pension reforms?
Well, right now he's got a plan out there that talks about $12 billion in cuts and 5 years in tax extensions. He's been going around the state. He went to a budget committee meeting this week, the first time ever a governor has done so, and had almost what was described as a question time sort of session with these legislators, in which some of the Republicans said, hey, we want pension reform. And he said, well, look, are you willing to do that? Let's talk about it. Let's put it up there. And immediately some of them retreated and said, well, but we want to hear about getting rid of the tax.
Let's see what you're really going to put up there first, Governor.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is an issue. The fact is, public polls are showing that right now voters seem to stand with the unions. The idea of taking away collective bargaining does not sit with most voters, either in Wisconsin or in California.
Labor is a very powerful force in California, especially the teachers union, the public employees union,
the California Nurses Association.
So how are they reacting to this?
Well, these groups have given, you know, millions of dollars to the Democratic Party. They've provided tons of manpower when it comes to elections, and they are not sitting still when it comes to this issue of Wisconsin. There was a demonstration this week in Sacramento. They're sending people to Wisconsin. They feel that they have got to stop this train in Wisconsin. As you mentioned, it's catching on in other states, Ohio, Indiana. The fact is that California has a different political makeup and has very strong unions, but there's no question the unions are under pressure to come up with pension reform,
the
and
table.
They're going to have to come to
and
the
if they
table
don't do it themselves, it'll something
happen.
Be on the ballot,
yes,
perhaps.
Exactly.
Okay, well, thank you very much. And Josh, a different kind of union story, I guess,
right.
You could say, in the news. I'm talking about unions between same-sex couples, the Obama administration saying that they have come to the conclusion that the Defense of Marriage Act is unconstitutional. They're not going to defend it anymore. Tell us what that means, especially for folks here in California.
Well, what it doesn't mean is that there'll be an instantaneous effect on the Prop 8 litigation, which is what we're dealing with right now.
And just remind us what that is.
The Proposition 8 was passed by voters. It was a constitutional amendment that defined marriage definitively as one man and one woman. And it's currently under challenge in the federal courts. A federal judge has found it unconstitutional under a couple of provisions of the 14th Amendment. It's gone to the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, in turn, has bumped a question of legal standing over to the California Supreme Court because the state has declined to defend it any further. And the proponents of the measure would like to do that, but there's some question of whether they're allowed
and
to.
And is this related to DOMA in any way, the Defense of Marriage Act?
In fact, no. and that's the thing. We're, you know, DOMA is a federal statute. Prop 8 is a state constitutional thing, and never the twain shall meet, except what we now have is the President of the United States opining that a federal law banning same-sex marriage cannot be constitutionally upheld. And although that is his opinion, it is his legal argument, it's something that some believe the courts may give some credence to going forward.
But it's still the law.
It is still the law. It was made very clear this week, even as the Obama administration said it won't defend this law in court anymore and against constitutional challenges, it is required to enforce the law until Congress repeals it or until the courts strike
and
it
what's
down.
Happening and what's happening on that score? Is anybody coming forward to challenge to
Dianne Feinstein within hours or possibly even minutes of the Obama administration's announcement promised to introduce legislation to repeal the Defense of Marriage Act once and for all. She said she was against it in 1996 when it was passed, and she's against it now. Easier said than done, considering that the House is in Republican hands at the moment, but it'll make a very interesting debate this year.
Josh, explain a little bit about the timing of the Obama administration decision with everything going on the international scene. Why now?
Yeah.
And how is this going to affect what we see in California in terms of
The why now is more of a legal question, although it certainly has political overtones. You know, in previous cases in the past 2 years, the Justice Department had defended DOMA by citing case law precedents that directed judges to uphold any law that treats gay people unequally unless a challenger could prove that there was no conceivable rational basis for the law. These two cases that the Obama administration is now choosing not to defend the law in are filed in a federal circuit, a judicial circuit, where no such case law exists. And so the Obama administration decided, and by that I mean President Obama and Attorney General Eric Holder in consultation, decided that gay people qualify for a greater protection afforded to a handful of classes like race and gender, a higher standard of scrutiny. And under that test, this law won't stand up.
Let me just ask, because the DOMA, what it does is it prevents the federal government from recognizing marriages that might be legal in, say, Massachusetts or another state, so that they can't give any kind of federal benefits to those folks. So couples in California who got married legally before Prop 8 passed and was upheld, How does this affect them? Does that mean that they can now sue?
In fact, some already have, and this will have, it could have bearing on that, depending on what happens now in these two cases. If DOMA gets struck down, as the Obama administration seems content to let happen, you would see a flood of litigation of same-sex couples that have married in various states that allow it, claiming federal benefits, spousal benefits or tax benefits, whatever. Keep in mind that although the Obama administration has now said it won't defend it, Congress could. And like I said, with the House in Republican hands, there could very well be an attorney hired by Congress to go into court and defend the law as it was passed.
How much will the conservative groups out there now, both here and nationally, use this? I mean, we already saw Newt Gingrich this week talk about the president being guilty of dereliction of duty on this decision, suggesting impeachment might be.
And the last time this was a big issue was 2004, when some people thought that's what did in John Kerry in Ohio.
Yeah.
So does it still have
that
bite?
Well, it's been an interesting reaction these last couple of days. Yes, there are a lot of conservatives who have voiced a lot of outrage about this. I think the interview you were referring to, Gingrich was saying that, if somebody else did this, perhaps it would be grounds for impeachment or something like that.
That's right.
I think that's more of a headline grabber. I think the reality is that some of the reaction has been actually a little bit muted on the right, and I think that's a result of you're starting to see a younger generation of conservative voters who are not having a problem with
same-sex marriage.
Well, and
they may realize that people want them to be focusing on the economy as well, and they don't want to be distracted. All right, Josh, thanks a lot. Well, gay marriage seems to be one of those issues that doesn't go away, not unlike water, Dan Brecke, in California. There was a big study that came out this week looking at the way forward on water, if I may. Give us some of the highlights.
Well, a couple of things are going on right now. Last week, a new state body called the Delta Stewardship Council issued a report on its first draft report on how to fix everything in the Delta. And what's everything? Number one, give everybody the water they want, every drop. And number two, make the Delta fish friendly forever.
It sounds like a Disney film.
Without being flip, of course, the Delta is badly, badly damaged from 160 years of having to coexist with us. That's the big problem for the Delta. Everything we do, from starting with the gold rush and sending entire mountainsides down the river, has damaged both the bay and the Delta and the wildlife within it.
Not to be too practical about this, but how much is it going to cost to fix
it's going to cost Carla.
I mean,
we'll get to that
situation.
We'll get to that
right now.
If you just keep your checkbook ready.
one of the things this didn't do is ask ag farmers to give up some of that water. They use far more water than cities do, for example. Why did they make that decision? And does that hurt their credibility with environmentalists, for example?
Well, I think it's early in the process. And I think, it seems like every hot political discussion has a third rail, asking agriculture to give up substantial amounts of water. That's a third rail in the water discussion. But this Delta Stewardship Council is just one thing that's happened. Another very interesting development this week is the Public Policy Institute of California has a panel of world-class water people, including a lot of folks from UC Davis, who have put out a report, 500 pages. They're not concerned about forests, they're concerned about water. 500 pages, and basically they're putting forward a new vision for how California water ought to be dealt with. Essentially, they want to try to cool everybody down and find some holistic decisions that would include, they actually use this kind of language, reconciliation among the communities that are and the interests that are fighting for the water. So there's a big environmental emphasis in their report, but they want to recognize the needs of city and farm water users, and by taking a more understanding approach, digging in less on issues, maybe make it possible
to come
to a long-term understanding.
We've been hearing for so many years that the Delta is not sustainable as sort of the heart of the system that we use for water for 25 million Californians. So are we going to hear talk again, or was there any mention in these reports about a peripheral canal, which last came up the last time Jerry Brown was governor?
Well, the peripheral canal is not a centerpiece of either of these reports, but it's always there in the background. There's a separate effort right now called the Bay Delta Conservation Plan, which is all about developing a peripheral canal or a super tunnel of some kind to take water farther outside the Delta, bring it around the Delta, and then send it south to the farms and the LA area. That is one of these things that both the new state group, the Stewardship Council, and anybody else who wants to mess around with California water is going to have to contend with. And that's where your money question comes in, because the pricing on that little item starts at about $13 billion. And looking at the long-term costs, the Natural Resources Defense Council put out a little item earlier this week where they quoted a price of $35 billion once you get done with everything.
Now, we've had a pretty good year for water in California. It's been very wet.
Year.
Does that sort of kick the can down the road, either in terms of the politics or in terms of the need to deal with this problem soon?
Well, we're a state that's living paycheck to paycheck, if you will. We hang on every single storm report, water report year to year. You know, California officially still has a drought declaration in place that Governor Schwarzenegger put in. It was never lifted, and part of that is explicitly because they want to try to create the consciousness of this is the way we have to live now.
You know, Governor Schwarzenegger had a water bond. It was at $11, $12 billion, yep. Got pulled back.
Right.
What's the relationship? What does that say about what these folks are recommending? Anything?
Well, I think what it really says is that was part of a complex set of legislation on this topic.
There was some pork in there, too.
There was lots of pork, and I think that was one thing that was going to make it very difficult to pass. I think the fate of that is yet to be decided, but I think just the difficulty in pushing that forward demonstrates how difficult paying for any of this in the future is going to be.
All right, Dan, thanks very much.